Good morning. Welcome. We've had a shift from Lake Theresa, which you would have seen a little bit of vision that we've managed to take of that. It was, we couldn't find just the right spot. But we've shifted to the town of Clermont, and we're at a place called Woods Lagoon, which is, as you can see from behind us, quite beautiful, and there's lots of bird life, and it's very pretty. So we thought that that would be a nice addition to our location worship. So today we're going to be exploring the theme of welcoming and being welcomed. And all around the world, people greet each other in different ways. And here are a few that possibly you might like to try out. For example, Tibetan monks stick their tongues out to greet people. In Japan, people bow. In Oman, men greet each other by pressing their noses together. The traditional Maori greeting in New Zealand is to press foreheads together and look into each other's eyes. In Malaysia, you stretch out your hand and touch the other person's fingertips, and then bring your hands to your heart as a sign that your greeting is heartfelt. In Kenya, you are greeted with tribal warriors performing a magnificent jumping dance. Why do I mention all those different ways of welcome? It's because God calls us to be a welcoming community, offering others a sense of belonging and hope. So our first song today, which will be on your song sheets that I've emailed out to you, is Across the Lands.
You're the Word of God the Father, from before the world began. Every star and every planet has been fashioned by your hand. All creation holds together by the
how you built the cosmos and guaranteed everything in it. Your love has always been our lives' foundation. Your fidelity has been the roof over our world. Let us pray. O God, your Spirit draws us into your presence. And so we come, drawn by love, upheld by grace, to encounter Jesus, our Saviour. In him we see the Father, whose love sent Jesus to us. Spirit, Son, and Father, we draw close in faith to offer our praise and worship. Amen. We're going to be singing now a couple of songs. Lord, I lift your name on high, and Jesus' name above all names, which are on your song sheets.
Lord, I lift your name on high. Lord, I love to sing your praises. I'm so glad you're in my life. I'm so glad you came to save us. You came from heaven to earth to show the way, from the earth to the cross. From the cross to the grave, from the grave to the sky, Lord, I lift your name on high. Lord, I lift your name on high. Lord, I love to sing your praises. I'm so glad you're in my life. I'm so glad you came to save us. You came from heaven to earth to show the way, from the earth to the cross, my debt to pay, from the cross to the grave, from the grave to the sky, Lord, I lift your name on high, Lord, I lift your name on high.
Jesus' name above all names.
Jesus' name above all names. Beautiful Savior, glorious Lord.
Our congregation is growing, and we've been joined by a goose that's enjoying Jim's music. Let us pray. Lord, thank you that you are our master and our friend, the vine of our branches, King of kings, Lord of lords. Forgive us when we forget that and stumble around in our own strength and along our own ways, that we forget that we can rely on you. You have authority over all things in heaven and on earth. And so, Lord, help us to be reminded of that each and every day. Amen. So our scripture for today comes from the Gospel of Matthew, chapter 10, verses 40 to 42. Whoever welcomes you welcomes me, and whoever welcomes me welcomes the one who sent me. Whoever welcomes a prophet in the name of a prophet will receive a prophet's reward. And whoever welcomes a righteous person in the name of a righteous person will receive the reward of the righteous. And whoever gives even a cup of cold water to one of these little ones in the name of a disciple, truly I tell you, none of these will lose their reward. In these words, as I said at the beginning of the service, the theme for today's service is welcome. And so a welcome is a greeting, something that takes place at the beginning of a meeting. And when it's over, we move into the real business of the meeting. We do this most Sundays at church. We welcome people into worship, into our church buildings, and into our times of gathering. And then we move into the real business of worship. So our passage today would ask us to take a longer and deeper look at welcome. As a noun, welcome is indeed a word of kindly greeting, someone or something that brings pleasure. We will welcome a return to gathered face-to-face worship in a few weeks' time. As a verb, to welcome is to be pleased about and encouraged or supportive of something or someone. It's when our actions and our words invite rather than reject someone else. Now, my basic grasp of grammar tells me that that means that nouns are naming words and verbs are doing words, and that there are two sides to the word welcome. And our verses from Matthew prompt us to consider two sides of the word welcome in terms of our faith living, both our welcome of others and our welcome of ideas, as well as our welcome from and by others. Many suggest that Matthew includes these words of Jesus in his Jesus story as a way of speaking to the practices of the faith community he is writing for. It's an in-house lesson. One indication that this might be so are the words following these words of Jesus in his gospel. Now, when Jesus had finished instructing his 12 disciples, he went on from there to teach and proclaim his message in their cities. His instructions around welcome are part of the disciples' instructions around their mission and how they go about it. And it remains an in-house lesson, if read that way, for those of us who are disciples today. I found that what at first appeared to be simple instructions as to how we should greet people are much more. For as I sat with these verses, I began to sense a challenge in them, for it appears that the success of their mission, be they prophet, a visionary, righteous one, a local leader, or little ones, disciples, depends on how they are received, welcomed, and some very intriguing questions began to form in my mind and spirit. So let's together consider the following. Does our welcome of each other, as seen by those not part of our faith community, encourage them to welcome the good news message we have to share? Or does what they observe incline them towards rejection rather than welcome? This line of thought will lead us to consider our way of living out our faith as a community of believers, as part of our mission, not just something that we do. including the mundane things of caring for buildings, the use of our buildings, our talk of our life together, our times of fellowship, our hospitality, and so on. How do we water people or offer people water, that which life cannot be able to be sustained without? It would also lead us to ask of ourselves about what it is we do as a faith community that would make us welcome in the wider community. Or do our practices look as though we are a private members only club? This hit home for me as I read a post on Facebook from the Spiritual Child Network that went like this. A request was made for some feedback around how families found online connection working during lockdown. I should mention that this is a British site. There was one response I found illuminating, as one parent wrote this comment: "We've gained so much from worship at home for the past 3 months and have attended worship more than we would usually do. One congregation we usually attend twice a month, but have worshipped every week with them and followed their Sunday school activities. Other than receive notices from our other church, we've not had any connection. There has been more gained in those 7 to 8 minutes than many other Sundays. As we've been visibly doing activities at home, we've also had more conversation with others that we wouldn't have usually had, except especially in partaking in Thy Kingdom Come Week. I feel more part of that one church community since being at home than I've done in the past few years, thanks to after church coffee via Zoom." Why did I find this particular comment illuminating? Certain things stood out. They've attended church more often than when it was face to face. They have found that they've had more conversations and deeper conversations, felt more welcomed and more hospitality given via Zoom than they did when meeting face to face. Lots of things in this response of this particular mum to the asking of feedback I found interesting, and it got me thinking. And it got me asking, why did this family feel more connected and welcomed during lockdown with no face-to-face physical gathering than when the church was able to do that? How did this distant worship and fellowship become more productive, encouraging and welcoming than face-to-face? And what does it say about how effective the other times are? I'll be honest, it got me to thinking about how we do things within the context of our gathered times, especially as we look to return to them. There is much good, but I wonder if it's time to consider how we might make it more welcoming for each other and others. Also, if in doing so, would the wider community be more welcoming of the good news we have to share and increase the success of our mission set by God to which we are called? This may mean some cost or even change will be involved, but these words of Matthew also indicate this when speaking of those who welcome and welcome well of receiving rewards. Unfortunately, when our translations today mention that they receive rewards, another translation might put it in this way, that they take on that which we are copying or imitating. And so it is the same way of phrasing it as it is when they speak, or when Matthew speaks of taking up our cross to follow Jesus. That comes later in this same chapter in verse 38. And whoever does not take up the cross and follow me is not worthy of me. Our reward is to do what Jesus did. Our reward, be it that we are a leader, a church member, a synod member, a moderator, doesn't matter. Be whatever we are, whatever role we have, our reward is that we do what Jesus calls us to do. And that it can be costly. So how ready are we to welcome new ideas and ways when we come back together face-to-face times? For God calls us to be a welcoming community, offering others a sense of belonging and hope. And that's the challenge that I find in these verses of Matthew. It's more than just saying good morning, stay for a cuppa. It's how we do it. And if we can be more welcoming to each other, how do we water each other? How do we offer that cup of cold water to each other that is offering life-giving things? Well, that's what we're called to be, a welcoming people in both word and action. Amen. Let's prepare for communion by singing the song on your song sheets, Behold the Lamb. Gathered at not one table but many, and each is the table of Jesus our Redeemer, be it your dining room table, kitchen table, or a picnic table at Hood's Lagoon. And at his table we find food for our hunger, food for our healing, and drink for our peace, drink for our forgiveness. In this simple meal at his table, we remember Jesus, his promises, and the price he paid for who he was, what he said, and what he did. This is a hope-filled meal. When Jesus knew that the time had for his death had come and the darkness was gathering around him, he shared a meal with his friends. Taking bread, he gave thanks, and then he broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "This is my body, given for you. Do this whenever you eat it to remember me." After supper, he took the cup. Then he gave it to his disciples, saying, "This cup is my blood, bringing new drink, new covenant and forgiveness of sins. Do this whenever you drink it to remember me." Say together with me the words in bold on your service sheets. Christ died, the witness that love is stronger than hate. Christ was raised, the witness that life is stronger than death. Christ will come again, the witness to us that hope is stronger than grief and despair. So now as we eat this bread and drink this cup, we proclaim that Jesus' life was not extinguished by death. We proclaim that Jesus' body was not held by the grave. And we proclaim the hope, healing and wholeness that we find in him. And we will keep doing this until our hope is fulfilled. So let us now share with whoever we are gathered with the bread and the cup. We thank you, O Lord, for breaking into our world, our lives, and our experience. We thank you, O Christ, for this meal of remembering and healing and the stories of love and grace that it tells. Amen. I want to read a few more verses from the psalm we started our service with, from Psalm 89, verses 15 to 18. Blessed are the people who know the passwords of praise, who shout on parade in the bright presence of God. Delighted they dance all day long. They know who you are. What you do, they can't keep it quiet. Your vibrant beauty has gotten inside us, and you've been so good to us. We're walking on air, and all we are and all we have, we owe to God. Holy God of Israel, our King. We're going to finish this morning with declaring that, with that simple chorus, He is Lord.
He is Lord. He is Lord. He is risen from the dead, and He is Lord. Every knee shall bow, every tongue confess that Jesus Christ is Lord.
Go in the name of Jesus to follow the way of Jesus, to love with the love of Jesus, and to be sustained by the peace of Jesus. Amen.